Welcome students, this is Kavita Jangra here and today we are going to study about the chapter number 4, yes, that is heat. But before I go ahead, I want to correlate this chapter with the chapter number 3 that we have studied before, that is fiber to fabric. If you thought about the same, I talk about the plant sources and the animal sources. The summer clothes, they are made up of the cotton, that is we get it from the plant source. And the cotton clothes that cools your body. And if we compare the woolen clothes that we derive it from the, yes, exactly the animal source, and the woolen having the property to entrap the air. Okay, so here it is acting as an insulator and it will not allow the heat to pass or go across that woolen cloth. That's why woolen are best for the winter as this provide us heat. Okay, so in this chapter I am going to take the few objectives of these are that to identify whether the object is hot, cold or warm bodies. How you will come to know about these? And to define the heat as a transfer of energy. Then to differentiate what is heat and temperature. To explain what is the clinical thermometer and laboratory thermometer. I think among these terms many of you know, but let us start now. Now here a matter to discuss that what is thermal energy. Thermal means heat and energy is something that is capable to do work. Say for example, when you are boiling a water in a tumbler and you put a plate on it, what happened? After some time you will see that plate on the, yes, vessel, it's starting moving. Why the movement is there? Because the energy that is created by the heat in the warm water, it possesses the plate on the utensil to move up, down. Okay, the same way in the case of pressure cookers, when you're opening it, what happened? The steam that comes abruptly when you remove the lid. Here, I'm talking about the thermal energy. Thermal means that is the heat that is created by a molecule. And here in the case of when you are rubbing your hand, that means the friction, due to the friction, the heat is generated and the molecules that are present in the substance that generate heat among each other due to rubbing. Okay, and that will allow the molecules to move faster and the heat is generated. In the case here, that thermal means heat. It is very clear from the term that thermal means heat and thermal energy that provide a heat or it made the heat to happen. How? By moving the molecules faster. In case of heat, when you have just light it up or when you are heating some water or in anything, what happened in that case? In that case, when you are providing the heat to the substance, the molecules start moving faster. Okay, so random movement occurs and the heat is generated, temperature becomes high. This is how the molecules, say for example, when we are the source, the heat source is given to the water object. The molecules are in this case. Here, what will happen, the thermal energy, it constitutes the potential plus kinetic. Here, need to understand what is potential and what is the kinetic energy. Every object or every matter in the surrounding possesses energy. When it is just lying, that means it possessed a potential energy, that is at rest, it's not moving. But whenever, say for example, when the heat is given to any object, in that case what happened? The molecules that becomes faster the movement and it pass on to adjacent molecules. The vibration started. In that case, the kinetic energy. Kinetic is that is possessed by moving object. So here the molecules are in this state, the closely they are close to each other as the heat is generated. What happened? The molecules get apart. Why? Because they movement, their movement started faster when they are given a heat. The source of thermal energy is given to them. So I think this is the basic concept that you need to understand before we go ahead. So here a question to you. Do you know any example in your day-to-day life that possesses a thermal energy? Yes, you might know, but few example I'm going to tell you. So these are the geothermal energies or volcanoes you can consider. And whenever you light a fire and holding a stick rod, say for example of metal, when you put it into the heat, what happened? It just slowly heating up the molecules. The movement of the molecules get faster as it get into contact of the heat. And boiling a pot of water. These are such the examples of thermal energy. So here I'm talking about again and again the heat is. Heat, when an object, that is particularly hot object I'm talking about here, that a hot object and a cold object, they both are in common contact with each other. And a type of energy flows. There is a flow of energy from the hot object to the colder one. And this energy, noted down here that there is a movement of energy from cold to the hot object. And this energy is known as a heat energy. And what is the SI unit? There is a unit to measure that energy. It's not like that just we just read the word and that's it. But we can also measure that. And its unit is, this is joule and denoted by J exactly. And calorie is the older metric unit. These were used in the past, but nowadays the joule, that is a standard, international standard unit, and joule is considered to measure the heat. This is how that I'm talking about the conduction of the heat, that when the candle is lighted up, what happened? In the earlier stage, our object is a cold, but when it get contact with the heat, what happened? The molecules near to the, yes, exactly, the molecule that is near to the burning candle, it start, it's moving, the molecules that is in the, it start moving in a fast position, faster rate. Slowly, slowly, it just increase the vibration and later on it pass on to the adjacent molecules, and so how it will pass on to the other one. And this end will be hotter and slowly the hotness will be felt to the other end also. How does heat move? This is a question that we are heating any object, but how does it move? There are the various ways that one is the transfer of heat when two solid touch each other. Say for example, when your mother is cooking a food on the stove, at that time, the two solid surfaces, as a heat is provided to it, and here, with the contact between the two solid, there is a conduction. Need to understand there is types of energies. One is the conduction that occurs between the two solids. Secondly, it the source of energy that is you are giving to it, that is a form of radiation. Okay. And internally, when the food is being cooked inside a utensil, there is a liquid inside it, then how that liquid becomes hot? Initial stage it was cold. But slowly when it gets the heat, the molecule movement get faster, and in the circular motion, the molecules start its movement and the whole material in that gets heated up. So this is how the heat moves. And this is the diagrammatic representation that how the heat is generated by the three ways, the convection, conduction and the radiation. This is how it occurs in the, yes, in the gas or radiation does not need any sort of medium. It travels in a vacuum. We will discuss it later on. Conduction, when the objects, two solids are in contact and there the transfer of heat takes place, the energy, exchange of energy takes place, that is a conduction. And within that liquid, the movement of molecules get faster as it get heated up, and here the change of energy, transfer of energy, that is a convection energy. This we will study in this chapter. So till now we discuss about that heat. So I think it is clear about that what is actually the heat is. Now here is the matter to discuss the temperature. Say for example, I just suggest you just do an experiment. You have to take the three tumblers. In a one tumbler, the cold water, and in the second one, the hot water. That must be that you can bear. And in the third one, that lukewarm water you have to take. If you put your hand in the cold water, what you will feel? You will feel that you are feeling the cold. And in the second tumbler, when in that water is hot, And if you put your second hand in that term, what do you feel? Yes, it seems to be that the giving you hotness. But even then, in the third tumbler, if you try your both the hands, are you able to recognize that which hand is feeling the hotness or cold? No, because here, the ones in the first hand, you are feeling the cold. In that lukewarm water, you will feel that it's hot. It will give you the hotness. But the second hand, when you put that in the tumbler of the hot water, in that case, you feel that it is hot. But right now, when you're going to put it in the lukewarm water, what will happen? You will feel that it is cool. That is not a reliable measure of to measure the degree of hotness. For the reliable measure, to the precise, there is a term that is temperature. And how we can do it? See, the degree of hotness and coldness, how much that substance or object possess the hotness and the coldness, that is known as the temperature. And the SI unit is Kelvin. So here you can see that the how the hot object and the cold object, due to the movement of the molecules, they are possessing the different temperature. So temperature is a reliable measure. So now let us discuss the reliable measure, the temperature I'm talking about. One is the, yes, exactly, the clinical thermometer. In this we will study about clinical thermometer and laboratory thermometer. In the thermometer, you all have seen the thermometer when you have gone to the doctor, when you are suffering from fever. At that time, doctor used to check by putting the thermometer below your tongue. And there, for the after 2 minutes, a reading is shown on that. That reading states that if you are feeling fever, if you're suffering from fever, the temperature should be high. So here, see, to measure the temperature, the instrument that is used to measure it, that is known as a thermometer. You must know that what exactly the thermometer is. It is used to measure the, yes, the temperature. So the body temperature, that is measurement of the amount of heat that is in the body. And secondly, the balance between the heat produced and the heat that is lost. That is in the case of the body temperature. And the normal adult body temperature, that is 37 degree, yes, that is 37 degree Celsius. This is all about the clinical thermometer, and more details you must know about it. That is, that clinical thermometer, how it looks like. If I ask you, you have to construct a thermometer and you have to write down the details, what you are going to write it. Before that, you must know it very well. So this is what, that it consists of a narrow tube. There is a capillary narrow tube. It is very thin. That is also known as a capillary tube. And that is of a thick glass. Many of you have seen the thermometer. And the end, at the end of the capillary tube, there is a thin. Here you can see that the thin, here this one is the area that is known as the bulb. And the bulb is filled with the mercury. Why the mercury is used in this case? Because the mercury expands quickly as it gets in contact with the heat. That's why the mercury is preferred, and it is liquid even at the room temperature. And the mercury is preferred in thermometer, as I state that it is in liquid state, and over a wide range of temperature, it is silvery grain color, and it's easy to observe it. Because in place of mercury, if you think about other, I don't think so, there might be alternate. But here the mercury is suitable, why? Because it is liquid in state. And secondly, you can observe it as the scale rises up, and it does not stick to the glass. This is the one important point over here, that it will not stick to the glass and in which it is enclosed. This is what the clinical thermometer is shown over here. Clinical thermometer that used normally for measuring the body temperature. And you must know that what is the human body temperature, that is 37 degrees centigrade. But point to be noted here, that 37 degree, every human does not possess a 37. It is an average temperature. That may, them, many of them having the below 37 or above 37, or maybe the 37, the borderline. That is a 37 degree average temperature. So the 37 degree Celsius, the last temperature range is 42 degree Celsius. Okay, and the small change between one to another scale, say for example 35 to 36, as you move on to graduation, the 36 number, there the small change is 0.1 degree Celsius. The capillary tube, here this capillary tube, this one I'm talking about, the, you can see over here that this is the bulb and kink is present. Kink is constriction, one fold is present. I'll let you know about this later, why this kink is there, what is the use. In this, there is a, this is a capillary, and in this, as the mercury get the temperature, the heat, it just rises frequently. Then the clinical thermometer, this has a kink and bent. Why? Because it will not allow the mercury to fall down at the same time when you are taking out that thermometer. This I will compare with the clinical thermometer, because clinical and laboratory, because in case of laboratory thermometer, there is no kink. Here, to measure the particular temperature at particular point, the kink is present in between. If kink is not present, then what will happen? The temperature that is shown for a particular scale, that will drop down soon and we are not able to mark it. I think you get it very well. And the thermometer, that is, if you want to check of another one, what will happen? Then you have to jerk it. You have to jerk like this so that it will come down to the 37, that to standard temperature, so that it can give a accurate temperature of the another person. So this is how the clinical thermometer looks like. This is the capillary tube, this is a bulb, and in the inside this bulb, the silvery color, this is a mercury. Why mercury is you chosen? Because it is liquid in state, and secondly, it rises frequently and does not stick to the glass wall. And the kink is present. The reason for the kink is that whenever you take it out from the mouth, it will show you the same particular scale of the temperature at which particular point it is measured. So if it is not there, then it, the say for example here 40 is marked, near about 40, what will happen if constriction is not there? It will drop down soon and it will not show you the particular temperature in this. So this is what about the clinical thermometer. And you must know that there are precautions how to handle it, because it is not like that we just study and we just leave it. So the precautions are these, that it should be washed before and after use with antiseptic solution. Antiseptic solution that is used to kill the germs. Then to read, keeping the level of the mercury, you have to just hold it like this way in front of your side so that you can measure it at a particular scale. You have to handle with care. Why? Because it is made up of glass, and if broken, the mercury is not easy to handle and it may also cause harm to our health. The bulb of the thermometer, that should not be touched. We should not touch a bulb of thermometer while taking a reading, because you hold the thermometer by its glass body, by the upper end. And it should be ensured that before use, before you are using that thermometer, what you have to do? That its temperature should be below 35 degrees Celsius or 95 degree Fahrenheit. 35 degrees Celsius, noted down, that this is how the 35 degree is equivalent to the 95 degree Fahrenheit. So till now you have to just recall it, that what is the clinical thermometer, what is thermal energy. In the next video we will just discuss about the, yes, the laboratory thermometers. I hope you understand. Meet you soon in our next video.